Just a few weeks ago, Blackmagic Design announced their latest achievement in camera technology. I am, of course, speaking of the URSA Broadcast G2. We will take a detailed look at this new camera here on VIDIVO Live. And a very warm welcome to our show from Munich. I'm very glad you tuned in. My name is Ivo Iliev, and today I want to talk about the most crucial differences of the URSA Broadcast G2 compared to its predecessor. Which features were added, what's still missing, and of course there are some features and things which I want to especially emphasize. Above all, we'll cut it a bit down to just talking about using this camera in a studio or ENG environment. This means shooting in full HD or ultra HD with before lenses. So, no extended dynamic range or shooting in Blackmagic RAW with Super 35 lenses. As this would extend our airtime massively. And in a way, this is already happening with me talking too much. So, let's move on. As both these cameras have such beautifully sounding names, for the rest of the show we'll just call them URSA Broadcast G1 and the URSA Broadcast G2, well, G2. Or maybe first generation and second generation, just to keep things simple. Well, I just hope I didn't achieve the exact opposite. Sounds good, right? I just want to add that I do not receive anything from Blackmagic Design for this presentation, so no money or no gold at all. It's weird you have to say things like this nowadays, or will this then result in like product placement? I don't know. Anyway, I want to clear things up, so the G1 I can still call my own, my property, and the G2 was provided to me for testing purposes. So let's get going. Straight after receiving the unit and turning it on, I noticed quite fast a ever so slight difference in the field of view on my super wide-angle lens. And by difference I mean I just like saw more. This confirmed my assumption on the G1 quite fast. I always have the feeling that this camera would kind of introduce a slight cropping on a before lens. So any lens optimized for a 2/3 inch sensor would look a bit zoomed in. I must admit that so far I did not have the opportunity to perform a side-by-side comparison between the G1 and a proper 2/3 inch camera, although I was pretty sure that the HA13x4.5 from Fujinon has a wider field of view on the shortest focal length compared to what I see on the G1 sensor, especially when one's aware of what this lens actually looks like on, let's say, an XD cam. So let's take a look at some footage now. Both cameras were mounted on the same tripod with the same lens attached, same focal length at the wide end, same camera settings and so on. You get the idea. And here you can clearly see the difference in the field of view. This, let's call it drawback, gets kind of fixed with the G2. Well, at least they tried. In opposite to the G1, the G2 Super 35 sensor gets cropped down to Ultra HD 2160 when using broadcast lenses. The G1 does not have a Super 35 sensor, so there's no stamp out happening. Unfortunately, with the G2 sensor cropped in, a slight amount of vignetting is introduced, especially with the super wide-angle lens from Fujinon. Take a look, just there in the upper left corner. And even with a standard zoom lens like the A22x7.8, vignetting is still noticeable. So mounting a matte box onto a wide-angle lens like the one seen on screen virtually becomes impossible. Once again, the left side of the image is affected. It appears that the sensor crop is not applied dead center, but rather with a shift to the left. Well, that's just an educated guess. So this tiny problem won't make you happy, but it also won't stop you from shooting. If I had the choice, I'd rather prefer a camera introducing little vignetting over a camera which crops in on a wide-angle lens which is not supposed to crop in. So what's the sense in using a wide lens then anyway? Maybe the manufacturer will manage to fix this issue with one of the upcoming software releases. This would be really marvelous. We'll see. Though there's a scenario in which the sensor crop actually opens up new capabilities on this camera. I'm talking about high-speed recordings. Shooting high frame rate was not really possible with the G1 as it's limited to 60 frames per second. The G2 allows for shooting with up to 120 frames per second in two ProRes files. The recording resolution is then limited to full HD and the 2.7K crop is automatically applied. Switching to Blackmagic RAW allows the operator to record even with up to 150 frames per second in HD. And for those who are interested in what the image looks like with the other sensor crops, this is footage with the wide-angle lens attached and the 5.3 sensor crop applied. And here we can see the full Super 35 sensor with the same lens. Well, that's quite useless unless you want to do some weird kind of art. Speaking of art, the G1 offers a very special and unique feature for doing art. It's called auto-white balance. In rather dark tungsten light situations, the camera measures about 2500 Kelvin color temperature, which is of course fine with dimmed artificial light, but then it sets the tint to something like minus 30, minus 40, and therefore creates a kind of greenish image, causing me manually to readjust the white balance. So why should I set auto white balance in the first place anyway? Comparing the G1 to the G2, it's obvious the new model performs way better during the measurement, which results in a more neutral image. When shooting in daylight, the G1 will do a more decent measurement but still introduce a slight red color shift. It's not as bad as the green tint we saw before, but even then I would tend to manually set the white balance. And I did hear some rumors about the G2 having the same sensor as the Pocket 6K or the Pocket 6K Pro. Please don't nail me down on this one. Anyway, it doesn't matter at all because simply the rolling shutter is still there and unfortunately it's even more noticeable when compared to the first generation. So producing live sport events with some super close-up shots and the background passing by very fast or quick pans will just look very unpleasant. I must tell you though, this is the second generation's most severe drawback. And yes, I'm quite sure this fact will stop many potential buyers from purchasing. And that's really quite a shame because, I mean, Blackmagic, what's wrong? I can clearly remember you guys releasing at least two cameras with global shutter technology. Why didn't this make it into the G2? Seriously, why? But there's also something very positive about the new sensor, which I want to emphasize. It's called Dual Native ISO. The sensor of the first generation does not have this feature, which means that recordings at 12 dB gain or higher are not that pleasant to look at. This may be okay in a real case of emergency. If you're planning on publishing your clips on the internet, let's say YouTube, this might also work for you. Because let's be honest, the image gets compressed quite a lot. And I highly doubt viewers will notice any noise when watching the footage on a smartphone, tablet or laptop screen. Should you be shooting for, let's say, a television program, I would definitely stay away from cranking up the gain too high. Unless, of course, all of your lighting equipment just blew up. Because, I mean, you still want to get that shot, right? On the G2, while raising the gain, you will notice a white flash in the image exactly at plus 10 dB. So the noise floor will raise up until 8 dB and then drop down immediately at the magical 10 dB mark. Side note, during those tests, detail sharpening was turned off on both cameras. In the switched on state, the noise will become more present. So even with the gain set to plus 12 dB, the overall image looks quite decent. Let's have a look at our waveform monitor and analyze the behavior of the noise floor while constantly raising the sensor's attenuation in 2 dB steps up until 18 dB. Well, I don't think I have to add anything to what you already see on screen. It's clear that the G1 sensor introduces a lot more noise compared to the sensor of the G2. Nevertheless, the new model, the second generation, will have some struggle in low light situations. Also, be aware of the before mount stealing about one stop of light according to the datasheet. Therefore, you can easily set the gain to 10 dB or higher without having to worry about the clips being a total waste or not meeting broadcast standards. Although, I have the feeling that broadcast standards kind of lost their meaning nowadays when looking at some TV programs. Now, let's talk about the SSD recorder. It fits between the battery plate and the camera body itself. And I kinda like the idea in the first place. Finally, no fiddling around with some tiny SD or CFast cards, which might get lost quite easily. And compared to SSD drives, they're just ridiculously expensive. I also really admire the look and feel. Inserting an SSD into the recorder personally reminds me of an XD cam disc or a tape you would use in an ENG camera. I said I like the idea so far, except for the one major drawback. With the first generation of the SSD recorder, one would occupy the camera's rear SDI ports. Imagine also connecting the viewfinder to the side SDI output. Now both video outputs are blocked. That's kinda cheesy, isn't it? What happens if one wants to connect an external display or monitor? That's right, nothing. I tried solving this issue by attaching an up-down cross HD converter to the side of the camera. As you can see in this photograph, the setup looks a bit weird but actually worked like a charm. There was just a limitation to 1080p as the converter does not support Ultra HD. Nevertheless, the fact that there was no official option of getting video out of the camera with the recorder and the EVF attached really bugged me. So this is how the first generation of the SSD recorder was operating. The second generation resolves this issue by connecting via USB-C to the camera body. This means the rear SDI connections will no longer be occupied. What a relief! So, let's just hope that this USB-C connection will be decent enough. And yes, the included USB-C cable can be locked into place on both ends with the non-included hex key. Anyway, I'm a bit skeptical of the ruggedness of this cable, especially when I look at this little loop which sticks out from the camera body. Speaking of recording, let's take a look at the dynamic range mode of both cameras. Just to clear things up a bit in advance, I'm only using the video mode when shooting with the G1. This is some sort of wannabe linear mode. Yeah, sure, there might be some people now asking me if I've gone crazy as this camera could do so much better. And yes, they might be right. Well, about the camera, not about my craziness. We should not discuss this certain topic. Not on this program. Let's just stick to the point. For me, it's all about being fast. On top of that, I'm not a color grader. I could not color correct the clips properly after shooting. I just want the footage to get as easy and as straight as possible into editing. So, all legal range and meeting the Rec. 709 color specs. If there's a requirement for extended dynamic range, then I will provide the clips in the appropriate format, of course. But I just don't get the sense in taking log footage and applying a simple 709 LUT. This seems a bit odd to me, but that's just a personal opinion. Let's go back to the so-called wannabe linear mode of the G1. Why wannabe? Well, because it doesn't have much to do with the definition of the term linear. The test chart you see on screen should result in linear steps on the waveform monitor. This is not really the case. Quick foreshadowing, this behavior will not improve on the G2. Legit studio or ENG cameras would normally display a proper linear cross as one would expect during color matching right before a show. Independently, the highlights will exceed the legal range standard if one happens to open up the iris too much. There shouldn't be any real image information above 700 millivolts or slightly higher. Another unusual behavior of the G1, let's say a certain part of the image clips in the highlights when looking through the EVF or the SDI output in general. Taking a look at the camera's internal LCD, this part looks just fine. After closing the iris a bit to compensate and looking again through the EVF, the image seems just correct, whilst appearing too dark on the LCD. If there is anyone to have a profound explanation for this phenomenon, please do not hesitate contacting me. Unless it's just a weak, weird assumption, because that's how far I got already. Alright, now what's the deal with the G2? Unfortunately, there is no real improvement considering linearity of the image. The highlight roll-off is definitely stronger and the picture therefore results in a more logarithmic touch, as you can see on screen. Things get fairly linear just below the 350 millivolt mark. And on the opposite side of the scope, it's virtually impossible to blow out the highlights above 700 millivolts when using video dynamic range. Seems like there's nothing really going on above 650 millivolts. Another interesting fact I would like to share with you, after hitting the magical 10 dB mark again, the highlight roll-off will be offset to about 600 millivolts and then raise again with every plus 2 dB step added. But let's just ignore all these wannabe scientific tests using a non-Tektronix branded measuring device, just for a brief moment. In my opinion, the G2 produces a more natural, more balanced image. That was already quite noticeable after performing the auto-white balance. The perception of the image just looks more neutral. For me, this is a clear advantage to the G1. Unfortunately, I must mention something else. In the recordings menu, I'm missing on some codec options like the DNX HD codec along with recording in 1080i, which was just removed on the G2. See, the interlace format is still in use nowadays by a lot of TV stations and broadcasters. Also, Apple ProRes is only available in 422, HQ and 422. Usually, I would use ProRes 422 LT, because in regards of quality, it's absolutely sufficient. And even then, the video files got incredibly large, especially when recording in Ultra HD at 50 frames per second. I must admit though that H.264 and H.265 do a very decent job encoding video, most of the times without any nasty artifacts, most of the times. In addition to that, the file sizes are very small, but using it as raw footage on an editing system, I am not so sure about that. No doubt the ProRes codec is just way more reliable. And there's also something interesting I discovered while testing around. If you own a video assist from Blackmagic, me personally I do have the 7-inch 12G model, then it's obviously possible to connect this up to the URSA's SSD recorder using USB-C. The video assist will then recognize the inserted SSD as an external memory device, and that's how far I got, because I did not do any further testing. So if you want to find out how reliable this actually works, please, be my guest and try it. Anyway, this is something you might want to consider only when you have the video assist permanently attached to the camera or its rig. This will re-enable you recording in ProRes 422 LT or even 1080i. Or you just go for the most simple way and just connect both devices using HD SDI. Speaking of the recording settings menu, I really need to make a compliment at this point. The very well-known Blackmagic operating system has improved quite a lot, especially in terms of clarity and settings. A few things have been changed, rearranged and got new labels. Also, there are some major performance improvements. I first noticed this regarding the communication between the lens and the camera and vice versa. I remember the G1 showing some weird iris and focus parameters, like a practically closed iris appeared as a value of 28. And when hitting the infinity and stop of the focus ring, this value is shown as something like 50,000 millimeters, I guess. This is no real showstopper when shooting ENG stuff. Nevertheless, lots of other cameras are capable of displaying those values correctly. Other cameras like the G2. On this model, this misreading got fixed, so a closed iris will display as a C and one of the lens's end stops is stated as INF for infinity. This really surprised me in a very, very positive way. What I would really like to see in the future are those values showing up as text overlay on the SDI output alongside the iris value. That's a feature almost every ENG and studio camera I've worked with is capable of. In regards of software, this should not be impossible to implement, as the camera is already reading out those values and baking them into the recording's metadata. You know, there are situations in which one could really benefit from knowing how much focal length there's left for a zoom in on air to avoid crashing into that end stop. There's another assumption I want to share with you considering the topic of lenses. But wait, I just asked for profound explanations myself, didn't I? And now I want to share a weak assumption? Great. Well, never mind. A while ago, Blackmagic announced full-sized electronic zoom and focus demands, which are already available, I think. Of course, the retail price is once again ridiculously low. Just to give you an example. Daniel, that's your cue. I paid for this worn-out, super-old, used analog ENG zoom demand from Fujinon. So this is not even the studio version, about 400 euros, and on top of that I got ripped off big time. Just because an important piece was not shipped. No doubt this zoom demand is indestructible, but I'm getting slightly off topic here. Let's come back to my assumption. I'm really, really sure the new zoom demand from Blackmagic Design, which by the way connects via USB-C, so no SSD recorder and zoom demand at the same time possible so far. I'm really sure that this will only work in combination with a digital lens. So when specifying on Fujinon, we are looking at lenses of the DigiPower series. This means practically all B4 lenses of the HA, UA, XA and ZA series should work. But there's also a non-HD lens which is also equipped with digital servo drives. It's the A13x4.5. This lens is the standard definition equivalent to the earlier mentioned HA13x4.5. I do also own this lens, so that's how I found this out. Just one thing you should keep in mind, even lenses with digital servos might have their serial communication turned off by default. In this case, the camera will recognize a DigiPower lens as analog and so it will not be able to read out the lens's zoom and focus values. And on the other side, the camera will not be able to control the lens, as this is a two-way serial communication. This happened just a couple of weeks ago, so I mailed Fujinon support for help, they got in touch with me super fast and sent me a detailed manual on how to enable and disable the serial communication. Another small problem solved. Back to the actual topic. Let's assume these zoom and focus demands work as precise and reliable as the original ones by Fujinon, or let's say Canon. Then this is going to be a massive competition. But once again, we have to check for the ruggedness of these accessories. Will they be strong enough built for the field or ENG production? I do not have any doubts on using the demands in a cozy and warm studio environment, but for outdoor productions with heavy weather influences and rather bad conditions during transport, this might not be the right gear. And please keep in mind, this is connected via USB-C, so no super heavy-duty 12-pin broadcast connector, as known from zoom demands, like the one I have here. Summarizing, I must admit that the G2 is taking a big leap forward. Not everything on this camera is perfect yet, for example, one can still hear its large fan, and there are a few flaws which hopefully will be resolved with one of the upcoming software updates, like the vignetting on B4 lenses. On the other hand, the capability of shooting in high frame rate is great and the footage just looks awesome. In overall terms, the new sensor is so much better than its predecessor, except for the rolling shutter. I definitely say that there's still some room for improvement and development. But there were and are some features announced which sound and look pretty exciting, like the wireless Talion camera control via an RTMP return channel using an ATEM streaming bridge. That really opens up new production possibilities for this camera and makes it quite attractive. I could also see this new model as an ENG camera because, let's be honest, this camera actually does a good job at what it's supposed to achieve. Shooting video in a very decent and, for most of the times, absolutely sufficient quality. Although I would advise anyone who's planning on using the G2 on his or her shoulder, you definitely want to purchase some proper third-party accessories enabling you to balance the setup right. Fact is, the camera body only having a lens and a battery pack attached will always stay front heavy, even with the SSD recorder in the back. This will lead to some fatigue or even pain in your arms and wrists and get you exhausted quite fast. But it's good to know that with the new sensor you can actually switch quite fast and with little to no effort to, let's say, PL lenses, regardless of whether it's a small compact prime lens or a servo-driven cinema lens. And now comes something quite daring. I cannot get a feeling out of my head that the G2 strongly reminds me of a camera built by a large, very well known and very well acknowledged German camera manufacturer. The certain model I'm currently thinking of also offers a Super 35 sensor, working with B4 lenses, and somehow is a 3-in-1 camera, isn't it? For super high-class ENG work, in a studio setup as live version, and used as a digital film camera for shooting documentaries. For example, I just wanted to share that thought with you as the resemblance occurred to me during a recent studio production with these certain cameras. So, with me having shared this very naughty and highly inappropriate comparison, we will now come to the end of our program. A big thank you to my excellent tech crew in the background and to everyone who made this quite extensive production possible. And of course, thank you for tuning in and watching. It was a real honor for me standing in front of a camera again after almost 9 years, I guess. So, this was VIDIVO Live. Have a good time and Servus from Munich. I'm going to go to the next one.